That's the thing. Have you ever poked a live salmon in the eye? Just like giving it a little poke? Have you ever poked a live salmon in the eye? Like
we should just do that. We should just do the episode. Probably.
You're listening to The Dollop. This is an American history podcast where each week I, Dave Anthony, read a story from American history to person with eyes and face.
Gareth Reynolds, who takes that as a compliment at this point, who has no idea what the topic is going to be about.
Cry, baby.
Welcome to the show. This is our first show after we've been officially doing the show for 10 years, which is crazy.
And you froze already.
Huh?
You froze already. I mean, you have Ethernet? You froze already.
Yeah. Did I really?
Yeah. That's the kind of bullshit I have to deal with on this podcast.
You know, most shows when they go 10 years, one of the characters start to become a little bit too big. You've become a little bit too big. And I've become dumber. That's what happens. The dumb guy becomes like mentally challenged.
Then the
you guy, you're now being like, God says, get off of my lawn officially.
Yeah, we're leaning into it.
But we should also promote the fact that our 10th anniversary show is still available. It'll be available for a little while.
6 months.
If people would like to watch that. You go to Veeps, right?
Yeah, so that's not going to come out as a podcast for 6 months. So if you want to hear it or watch it.
James Adomian was our guest.
James was so good. People really enjoy it.
Yes, it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. It's long, but people like that stuff.
17 hours.
We know that we did it live, and some people tried to watch it live, and some people had issues watching it live. Mm-hmm. There was someone in the comments telling people to refresh it, but if you didn't see that, then it was jumpy and, you know, not the best. So that's not ideal, and we apologize for that.
But it was supposed to have been fresher.
It was supposed to have been refreshed a lot, way fresher. So we know that, we know that, and we also know that people were, you know, complaining a little bit, and that
a couple people got beaten by cops.
It was not met with the maybe greatest response, but
yeah.
But it's still available, so it works now. If it didn't work when it was live, we do fucking apologize. If we do another one of those, we'll make sure that is.
I'd like to say we apologize without the swearing.
We fucking apologize. But yeah, I mean, it's definitely worth a watch. So if you did purchase it, you know, it's good to go. So fucking watch it and fucking enjoy it.
Fucking enjoy it.
But yeah, so now we've been doing the show for 10 years, which is just absolutely
feels strange. Like 20, basically. Have you worked with you?
Isn't it strange though? Do you feel that strange? I didn't think it was strange until it was over. Now I'm like,
I mean, I'm dead inside, so I don't know.
You're just like a Spencer's gift keychain with negative catchphrases.
That's right.
I'm dead inside. What do I know? It's like 20 years. Have you worked with you? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. You get it.
It's also probably worth watching the Veep show just for the outfit I have. Because it's
great.
A lot of people talking.
What's going to happen? Talking. What's happening with that outfit now? Are you selling it back to
the
costume
store? It's going to a Hard Rock. The Hard Rock has asked for it. The Hard Rock Las Vegas wants to display it. So...
I'm done.
Live episode of The Dollop.
Yeah. We go on tour next week in Australia. Starting
so
on the 12th, we have Pastimes in Perth. And then we're doing on the 13th, The Dollop in Perth. And then we continue on to the other cities.
Do you want to say who our guest is for the Perth one?
We don't have him yet. It's not official. Okay. And then we go to Adelaide Adelaide's last, but we go to Melbourne and Sydney.
Adelaide,
and Canberra,
Sydney, Brisbane.
Brisbane.
And, all the and hits. Adelaide. We're peppering in some Pastimes. We've got the Dollop.
We're doing Pastimes in Perth, Sydney, and Melbourne. We're not doing one in, we were going to do one in Brisbane, but you guys are having a
football.
What I would call a really dumb football tournament.
Football time.
So I guess, you know, I guess do that on the weekend we're in town. That's really cool.
That's actually what I'm going to do while we're there. I'm going to make a weekend of it. I'm excited.
What are you going to do?
Just do whatever they're doing. I mean, you handle the work stuff and I'm going to take the weekend and get footy, like they say. So
no one says that.
If you were any fish, what would you be?
That's a tough one.
I know the answer. Why would you? Grouper.
I don't think I'm a grouper.
I'm a clownfish.
Of course you're a clownfish.
This was
fun. Of course you are.
Is this what the show is after 10 years?
Yeah, people are sad.
I don't like it.
Most people are sad. People are like, the show has changed.
It jumped the clownfish.
People are like, it's changed to the point where it doesn't even make sense.
What if we stopped doing history and it did just start to be All right, David, if you were to be a breakfast cereal, what would it be?
Oh, Kix.
Crazy answer. Cookie Crisp.
Cookie Crisp?
Yeah. Because it has my two favorite things, cookies and law enforcement.
who's the cop? What, there's
the
a cop
on the front. They're arresting the guy who's like, on the cover of Cookie Crisp, it's like some guy's like trying to steal the cookies or something.
Just so you know, it's not the cover of Cookie Crisp. It's the box.
I want to make the cover of Cookie Crisp. So Annie Leibovitz is shooting me. I'm doing the cover of Cookie Crisp. That'd be so. A cereal should do that. I guess Wheaties kind of did. Oh, now they don't have the. No. Yeah, no, there's a cop. There's a cop. He's like upset at the robber guy or something.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's fun.
He was. The Cookie Crisp guy is just stealing cookie. I don't understand it. It's a really nobody look, does. But I don't understand what's going on now with our law enforcement.
I mean, nobody understands. Oh, no, our law enforcement's great. What are you talking about?
I value them.
There's nothing going on that's weird.
Yeah.
I'm trying to change this. Oh, no, I'm doing that wrong. There we go. Sorry, I was just having a little moment with my tilt on my cam, and now I've changed a little bit, and looks sexier. We're talking about Dave Anthony.
Let's just start.
Okay. We already did the thing where we say this is the dollop.
Yep. That part's
and
over.
And now we're going to, okay. And go. You start. Okay. This is it again. This is an episode that we, have done. This is, from our last tour.
And we've done, but nobody's ever heard.
Right. Because what happened was, this is another one where the guy was like, I got this. This is one where they have like a special guy in a booth, and again,
what happened?
Nothing. He didn't record it. So,
what city?
San Jose, California.
Okay,
the land of
freedom,
tech fascists.
Yep,
is that right?
I don't know. It's definitely San Jose is kind of a strange little town.
Yeah, well, they're not great right now. They got to be honest with what they're doing. All the rich guys are really bad. July 19th, 1845, year of our Lord, J-Town.
Yep.
You have any words you want to say about J-Town?
No. I think like it's all gotten a bit cartoony, if I'm being honest. So.
Yeah, I'm sorry, everybody. It used to be a fun podcast. George Britton Little was born in Clay County, Kentucky to David.
Britton Little?
Britton Little.
Okay.
L-Y-T-T-L-E.
Okay.
If that makes a difference to you.
Doesn't.
He was born to David Yancey Little and Drusilla Posey Britton Little.
Drusilla?
That's a fucked up name for a girl.
Yeah, Drusilla definitely sounds like a name that, like, when Bugs Bunny was in a dress, he would give.
It's rough.
Okay, Drusilla.
Drusilla was the daughter of General George Britton, a large landowner and often called the father of Harlan County, Kentucky. George's father was a prominent attorney and later a judge. Okay. So, you know, fancy guy.
Yep.
He was described as a great lawyer, statesman, and public speaker, famed for his intellectual achievements, natural eloquence, courteousness, and grace of speech.
Or remind you of anyone?
Me. Dave Anthony. Dave Anthony. You're looking at him.
I can hear you.
Isn't that who you were thinking of?
No.
Let me read it again. Intellectual achievements, natural eloquence, courteousness, and grace of speech.
You heard courteousness in there, right?
Yeah, you fucking piece of shit. I did. What do you, why are you? Just,
come on. I mean, it's like so obvious that you undercut. I mean, that was immediate.
The Barberville Mountain Advocate said David was a devout Christian and, quote, was never known to carry a weapon, touch a stimulant, or take the name of God in vain.
It's un-American at this point.
He sounds really boring.
Yeah.
Doesn't he?
Yeah. These people have never tried a stimulant. Come on.
Yeah, who wouldn't try? What's the problem with a stimulant?
It's like, it's shocking to me how people can get through their life with none of that.
Right? What about, I wonder what, so stimulants back then, I mean, they had, what's 1845? Do you think they had?
Coke.
They had caffeine, yeah. Probably caffeine.
They had caffeine, but they also had Coke. They had coffee, Coke.
You're talking about cocaine. I mean, I think they're when they talk stimulant, I think they're talking about like caffeine and coffee and everything, like not just Coke.
It's amazing that in a time with cocaine, a ubiquitous cocaine era, you're like, I need a cup of coffee. I mean, I would just be banging lines. I would have died. Yeah. I would be banging lines.
I don't know what's going on right now.
I'm just saying. Who needs caffeine?
Oh, boy. There's a lot of dogs barking right now.
What's your deal? Do you live in a shelter?
Yeah, I have 17.
Okay, because you're like one of those Instagrams dogs that I follow where I'm like, man, this guy needs more funny, like money for raw meat.
I took in 17 dogs.
Okay. Because it does seem to be like there's group dog mind going on at your house.
All my dogs were cast-offs from Biden or Ellen DeGeneres. He would go on to serve as Kentucky State Senator from 1867 to 1871 and be remembered as the father of free education in Kentucky. So his dad.
Her dad.
So George Britton's dad he's great. This is a fucking top-notch individual. George was the first of 11 kids. A lot of that going on. When he was five, the family moved to Harlan County, and he got the best education.
Okay.
Everyone noticed George was very bright. It was expected that he would also be an attorney. And when he was 15, the Civil War started.
Okay.
Good time.
Yeah,
good time.
Absolutely.
15 is the prime age for a war to start.
Well, this kind of war, too.
Yeah. On May 16th, 1861... the Kentucky legislature declared the state neutral in the war.
Hard to take a stance
on slavery. Hard to take well.
It shows you how low the bar is because I'm like, I'm proud of you, Kentucky. Wow. Good for you.
If you had to guess, you would have said
100% pro
slave state, just like 100%. You thought Benjamin Franklin was a president.
I don't understand why, you know what, that happened almost 10 years ago. It is time to stop it. Okay? It is not crazy. It is not crazy. Shut up. It is not crazy to think that the man on the $100 bill who invented electricity from kiting was in charge at one point. And by the way, this is before I knew people were listening. This is when we would just... We were all saying stuff back then. We were all just letting it rip, seeing what stuck back then. It was a different time. We were you could posit the thought that potentially Benjamin Franklin was a president.
Sure.
And then get away with it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't talk to me like you're Scooby-Doo.
So Kentuckians, because of this, they could fight in whichever side they wanted to fight in.
Wow.
Families were divided, and that led to the phrase brother against brother.
Right.
On July 1st, 1863, George rode to Virginia and joined up with the Confederate Army. We have a hero.
Such an easy choice.
Yep. So he works as a courier. He's carrying messages. He's often going through Union lines. He once had his horse shot out from under him, but he managed to escape on foot.
Okay. And the horse?
I assume.
Made it.
Yeah. There was a lot of, they had a lot of horse surgeons.
Yeah.
Always operating on horses.
Pony medics.
Even if I was fighting a war, I don't think I'd want to shoot a horse.
Like, I agree. The whole thing would be, it's how I feel now. Like, I'm like, yeah, I definitely don't like, you know, I don't like people getting hurt. But if I see an animal hurt,
yeah,
it's very different.
The only way, the only way I like an animal to be hurt is if like a governor shoots a dog in a gravel pit.
So, okay, we should address this because this is a huge story. Listen, a lot of people are on Kristi Noem's ass because she killed a dog that was difficult.
Useless.
What is she supposed to do?
Thank you.
What is she supposed to do? And she killed a goat and two horses. What is she supposed to do?
Yeah, you can't not, like, if a dog isn't doing what you want.
A puppy? Puppies are supposed to be fully trained by the time they're puppies.
Puppies at 3 months should be fully trained.
They should know what you're doing. Yeah. If your dog doesn't catch a Frisbee at 5 months,
put him
it's
down.
Over.
Put him down.
It's done.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, now I want her to run for president. I didn't before, but now that I know she kills puppies. It's a real talk. She's making bold choices.
How great. I mean, it just shows you the lunacy of people in politics now.
Yeah.
100%. Where she didn't say that in an interview.
No, she wrote it in a book.
In her fucking book.
Other people read it.
She's like, that's how you got to make tough decisions.
I mean, people are going to love this.
I mean, honestly.
Yeah, it's the worst political decision I have ever seen in my life.
It's such a cell phone. I mean, she was going to be like the vice president.
She could have said I molested kids and it would be less hated.
Yes, I agree.
Okay. We finished discussing that topic.
Thank you.
So he joins the Confederate Army and he works as a courier carrying messages. The horse gets shot out from under him and he runs away on foot. But on November 12th, 1863, he was captured and sent to a prison in Columbus, Ohio. Hmm. But he's young. So on December 23rd, 1863, he's paroled under the condition that he go back to his family and never take up arms against the U.S. again.
Okay.
We should do that with some people here now.
Yeah, so easy. And I believe we could have, but we didn't.
George,
we'll beat him the old-fashioned way by losing.
Yeah, there we go. What? George goes back to Harlan County, and he studies law for the rest of the war. And eventually, he is admitted to the Kentucky Bar.
Ah.
So he's a lawyer.
Sure.
On November 13th, 1865, his mom died 2 weeks after giving birth to a brother who died 2 months later. It's called
The
Devil.
That woman was just, she didn't have much. She was just kind of a suit that children popped out of.
Yeah, she had one purpose that they were working with there.
She just kept, she must have been stacking them too.
I mean, he's like,
there had to be like a line.
He's like 18 now, probably, or something like that.
So she pretty much was in, if she wasn't with child, almost. She was recovering, getting ready for another.
Because he had 11. That doesn't 11. Mean 11 lived. I mean, she could have had 18 kids in 18 years, right? Or, you know, that would have been a little. Yeah.
That's a lot.
That's probably what we're talking about, though.
Yeah. Ugh.
That's what I'm looking for in a wife, myself. So George is heartbroken. He really loved his mommy.
Yeah.
He becomes very despondent. He got a license to practice law, but he was really drinking a lot now. And he really couldn't do the job being drunk, unlike my dad, who could do it.
Well, your dad was thrown out of court once for being drunk.
But he could do the job.
Yeah, he could do the job.
Yeah.
And what's great is other people, when it came to your father, could also get the job done.
What does that mean exactly?
I'm sure that what he was doing, other people could do.
10 years in, let's just come clean. We're 10 years in.
Sure.
Let's just come clean about stuff.
Yeah, of course.
What'd you do?
To what?
To my dad.
I didn't know your dad.
Did you kill my father?
No. He's a hell of a man, though.
Gareth, did you kill my father?
I had a complicated relationship with your dad.
Did you use your bare hands?
Your dad was an amazing man.
Did you use your bare hands?
So what's going on now? So he's killing his dad?
This is a prominent family, right? His dad's like a senator. So he's an embarrassment. He's the drunken embarrassment of the family.
Yeah.
Yeah. He can't pull himself together. And he decides enough is enough. Quote, I left Kentucky in 1866. I'd become addicted to drink. And so as not to distress my relatives and friends, I thought it best to leave them, at least until I could free myself from that inordinate appetite.
So he did the Irish exit with his family.
Yeah, he was like, it's what alcoholics call geographic. He's like, what if I go over there?
You just hide.
Yeah, you're like, I'll be not drunk
you
that way.
You need to stop. Well, out of sight, out of mind.
So he leaves that. He doesn't tell anyone. He's just gone.
Okay. Yeah. It's the Irish exit.
And he didn't know where he was going. Right. He just rambled around for a year, and then he ends up in Los Angeles in 1868.
Wow. Jesus, that's quite a ramble. That's
some serious rambling. I probably would have still been in Kentucky.
Yeah. He probably was.
Yeah. Thought it was LA.
Los Angeles.
There's the
big where all your entertainment dreams are a potential.
Quote, at length, I became almost besotted, grew desperate, and drifted into the worst company in California. To satisfy my appetite for drinks, I began to rob stagecoaches, taking only the treasure belonging to the express company, Wells Fargo and Company.
Well, and then it's like, okay, so he's pro-slavery, but he's also going to steal specifically from Wells Fargo.
He's awesome. Let's be honest. He's awesome. Yeah. This guy's
great. And when he stole from them, he should have charged them an overdraft. I said, when he stole from them.
His tactic for stagecoach robbery was to hide out on a route, step out with a bandana over his face, and then the guy on the stagecoach would yell, masking doesn't work.
Cook!
He'd step out with a bandana on, pistol out, and he'd demand the strong box. So a Wells Fargo is... Jesus Christ.
Sorry, it's a lot of babies.
Jesus.
I apologize. That was a lot.
A Wells Fargo strong box was wood with reinforced iron straps.
Okay.
So fully loaded with gold, it would could weigh up to 150 pounds.
Okay, fuck me.
So those of you who are listening to other countries, it's like 7 kilograms.
Here, I'll tell you in British stones, it's about it's about 8 stone.
I love when people make fun of us for ours, and then the British say, "I weigh 13 stones." You're like, "What in the fuck are you
They're
talking
still
about?"
Doing
it's really,
it.
Yeah, it's really wild.
Stone.
I'm 7 trees.
Stone.
So writing in his later years, he explained that he was a relatively gentle criminal.
Okay.
Quote, in none of the apparently desperate encounters in which I became entangled in my youthful adventures, did anyone get a bullet or a stab by myself. I was out for money, but not for blood. I would aim at affluent corporations and never molest poor persons or private individuals.
Molest, one of those words that it's just evolved into something different or synonymous with a different act. Okay, so he's a Robin Hoodie kind of feller.
Mm-hmm.
He's going for the rich.
That's what he's saying. Corporations. Okay. Corporations
and the affluent. Okay, I love it. No, we
just,
like this.
Just affluent
it's
corporations.
It's a real shame about the pro-slavery stance.
That is the one sort of...
Because that's a shame. That's a tough starting point.
That's a bit of a stain.
And it will remain on his permanent record.
Yep. So despite this, he quickly became a notorious fugitive in the Los Angeles areas. And cops named him the Lone Highwayman.
Nice.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
It's an all right
name. I'm surprised they had highways.
I think any dirt road was considered a highway. Huh. The highwaymen were what at this time they called robbers in England who would rob people on the road.
Can you name all the highwaymen from the country group?
Frank the Stilts.
Johnny Cash.
Mr. Pants.
Willie Nelson.
Old Man Rocks.
Waylon Jennings.
Sanchez the Diaper.
And Chris Christopherson.
And Mr. Googly Eyes.
Okay. I forgot you were talking during that.
George. George decided to lose his old identity to spare his family further embarrassment, and he chose the name Dick Fellows.
Great.
It's quite a name.
Yeah. Now, is he doing anything there? Because that sounds like it would, like, it does sound like a porn actor.
I don't know if Dick has the same meaning back then. No. I don't know if they use Dick.
No, yeah. He's like, well, I was molesting several different names. When I molested Dick, I realized it was good to go.
I should change what I said. I said, I don't think people were using Dick. I should say Dick wasn't a name.
Sure. Yeah,
people were using Dick.
Well, I mean, look at his parents. Yeah, clearly, yeah, dad was using Dick.
Oh, 100%. On October 15th, 1869, Dick Fellows tried to rob the Wells Fargo Stagecoach in Santa Barbara County. The Los Angeles Daily News, quote, on the last down trip near Santa Barbara, an adventurous knight of the road attempted to stop and rob one of the coaches of the Coastline Company. His modest request to halt was answered by a volley of pistol bullets. A shot which laid open his cheek caused the highwayman to beat a hasty retreat.
Oh, shit. So they cheek shot him.
He got cheeked.
How fucking great would it be to, like, go on a train now and try to rob it?
Great.
Just to really be great. Like, everyone relax. Mm-hmm. I've been in a coma. I was in a block of ice and someone just thawed me.
A train robbery should come back. Like, that would be really.
Yeah. If you were on, I mean, I don't know the last time you were on a train, but man, fucking A, it would be a little excitement in the mix.
Yeah.
Being robbed.
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. Okay. So someone shot him in his cheek.
He retreats. After Dick hit out with his friend Ed Clark at Ed's cabin near Castaic. Today, this is on the land that Magic Mountain theme park is on today.
It's just so nice to know the future of the place and that it remains historically relevant with the Six Flags.
Mm-hmm. Ed told Dick he should leave behind banditry and help him invest in a hog farm.
I'm telling you, you got to stop with your highwayman life. The future is hog farming. Now, I know you're probably getting a big kick when you walk onto that Wells Fargo train with your pistol out and you're demanding boxes of gold. Boy, that sounds like a hell of a rush. But have you ever tried to chase a greased up pig through a bunch of sloshed mud?
No.
It's also quite a rush. I'll tell you what, that is as good as it gets.
It doesn't
you
sound
want a
like
real
it.
Rush. Yeah, try to get a swine. Why? Get dragged through some dirt with about a swine running away from you. That's
you get also- dragged through the dirt by a swine.
I have been. Oh.
I thought you were.
It's a simpler life.
Oh.
It's a simpler life.
So
look, in this economy, you got two options, highway train robbing or swine farming. Pick a lane.
I'm gonna go rob the, right. I'm gonna go rob the stagecoach.
All right. Behave with my piggies.
So Dick agrees. He's like, okay, I'll hog farm it. They combine their money and it's about $2,000 and Ed buys 600 hogs and enough food to get through the winter.
It's a big invest. It's like when your buddy's like, I bought 100,000 in Bitcoin.
Yeah, it really is.
He said all 600 from 600 none hogs. To 600.
Yeah, none to 600. They went straight to 600.
All right, that's a lot.
They carefully stacked the supplies in a grove of sycamore trees on the federal rangeland where they planned to graze their livestock.
Okay.
Now, not wanting to be seen in daylight, Dick returned to the cabin while Ed stayed on the range.
Okay.
And a few hours later, when Ed was back, they heard a massive explosion that sounded like cannon fire. So they rode down to the grove.
Bay of pigs.
And they find that Ed's cook fire had gone off and gone wild. It's a wildfire. And it set the grove on fire and ignited gunpowder that they had under their supplies. And everything was blown to pieces except one bag of flour, which was now at the top of the tallest tree, and a single bottle of aguardiente, which is a liquor of some kind.
So, and that's just, so they have no, all the stuff they were going to feed the pigs is gone.
It's all gone.
Except for and one bag of flour that blew up into a tree and a bottle of liquor.
That they were going to eat too.
Right. Yeah, right.
So they go back to the cabin. And Dick drinks the booze, the bottle of booze, smart, and said man. And said he's going to go to L.A. and rob a stagecoach.
Has to. I mean, he's got this great skill.
Yeah.
Yeah.
On December 7th, 1869, the Soledad stagecoach was headed from San Fernando to L.A. At 1 o'clock, when Dick popped out, pistol in hand. Hey.
Come on.
Come on, you're middle-aged
just, come
man.
Come on. You're stop middle-aged it. Man. You you're stop it. Man. I'm not middle-aged. I'm the teen of the show. Oh, by the way, we should point out to the doll heads, the fans of Dollop, the doll heads, man, you guys brought the fucking hammer down Saturday night. It was like we were doing an opera with roses. So many doll heads hit the stage. Dave, your barber friend gave you a doll head to sign.
Yeah.
It's a movement. Did. One that we both co-signed.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's exciting to find our footing. Anyway, you were saying this guy's dick popped out. What's up?
So Dick pops out, pistol in hand, and yelled, "Hold up there, driver." And the driver shouted back, "All right.
I'm taking it pretty good."
And he stopped. And Dick yelled at the driver to throw out the strong box. But before he could, a man got out of the stagecoach and started shooting.
Okay.
Which spooked the horses. And the stagecoach takes off. Dick's horse also takes off because I guess he's like, "We're running. Our horses are running." And he goes too. So Dick hid for cover as the shooting guy's marooned now because he has no way to get out of there. He keeps shooting. And Dick yells, quote, "Hurry up, Bill. You and John go around on one side and I'll take the other." Smart, right?
This is before people use their brains. So when a man does, you're like, oh,
"What
no.
the? He's I'm surrounded.
Friend.
I'm surrounded."
I mean, that must have worked so effectively.
Yeah. Well, the guy thinks he's surrounded and yelled he's going to surrender. And Dick goes and takes his gun and his money, which is about $350. And the man's like, "Can I get $50 to go back home?" And Dick gave it to him and set him off saying, quote, "Next time, keep out of difficulties that do not concern you."
I gotta remember this. That is amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen.
What a kind robber. Can I have bus fare? All right.
Sure, you can. But this happens a lot in our stories when there's a robber and people ask for their money back. They always give them a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, it is nice. It would be not. It would be very. I mean, that's what would be great in this country we live in now. We're all getting screwed and robbed, and it'd be great if they're like, "You could stay in your house."
Or stay in our house?
Yeah.
Oh, if you get evicted, you mean?
Yes.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Hi. Okay. That is such a smart tactic, too.
So Dick finds his horse and he rides towards LA. He stops at a store in Cahanga and he buys supplies and he sends them to Ed. And around 8 o'clock, he stops a stagecoach in the Cahanga Pass.
Are you saying Cahanga?
Cahanga, yeah.
You have the same trepidation I do with that one.
You do?
Whatever. That one in Sepulveda. Took me about 8 years before I was like, I can to say them.
I don't care also.
I know.
This is an important part. Yeah.
I know.
It really upsets people. They still talk about it. 10 years in, they don't get. Yeah. My favorite one is. Some guys were talking about pronunciations the other day, and some guy was like, "And the way he says
pronunciations,
the way he says Calvary," not realizing I've been fucking with those guys for 10 years.
Is that what you've been doing? You're trolling people.
Calvary and Calvary, yeah, they lose their minds when you switch them up, and so yeah, I've been trolling them.
Well, I believe it's called trolling.
Once again, a passenger began shooting, and the coach's horses took off. This time, Dick jumped on his horse and chased the stagecoach down the hill and into the L.A. basin.
Okay.
Awesome. He cut through a valley right where the Hollywood Bowl is today.
Okay.
And got ahead of the stagecoach, and he took off his hat and cloak and put them on a fallen tree nearby. And then Dick hit on the other side of the road, and when the stagecoach approached, he yelled out, quote, "Don't shoot, boys, till you get the signal."
Wait, is he doing the voice of Tree Him?
No, he's not doing the voice of Tree Him, but he's just saying there's more than one of them, right, and they see
he's doing the same thing.
Yeah. The passenger with the gun jumped out and ran towards the clothes on the tree on the other side of the creek bed. And then Dick walked up to the driver and yelled, quote, "Throw out Wells Fargo's treasure box." Ugh. And the driver threw it out, and Dick got on his horse and made $485.
But meanwhile, that guy was like a Tree Him, like, "All right, mister, I told you real good. Now you stay there and be quiet, and I'm going to slowly approach you and take your gun away from you now."
Boy, he's a real quiet one, isn't he?
All right, mister. Now, before I say anything else to you, I want you to sit there quietly and quickly and take off your hat there, mister. This guy sure ain't talking back, guys. I think I'm going to have to put some lead in him and open up a couple more holes for him to speak through. Well, it seemed like he didn't react at all to them bullets. I think this gentleman's out of blood here. He ain't even bleeding. As a matter of fact, I knocked off some flesh, and I believe I see his brown twiggy bones.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah, hold on a minute. I'm negotiating a situation with this man.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, listen here, sir. If you don't make a move soon, I'm going to have to put more bullets inside you.
Hey, we got robbed 15 minutes ago. The guy
this
already left.
This guy here, yep. I'll tell you what he is. He's replaced all his bones with wood.
He's a tree.
And a couple of bramble bearers.
That's a tree.
Now, hold on a minute, boys. I think we're going to have to duel this one out ourselves. Backs to one another. 10 paces.
He's a tree.
10, 9, 8, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. He ain't even moved an inch.
He's a tree.
This guy sure is a tree. Seems like he ain't got blood running through him at all.
No, he's an actual tree.
He's unshakable.
He put the cape and the hat on a tree.
He's got a bird on his arm. This guy comes with a falcon. All right, mister, look, I dropped my weapon. I want no piece of this anymore. Look, do what you must with me. I'll drop my pants, and if you see something you like, just do what you like and get out of here, okay? We ain't looking for a fight no more. You done scared the dickens out of me already, sir. Well, fine, if you need me to. I guess I will manipulate my own flesh in front of you. Just don't let the fellas back at my wagon see it. Fine, I'll jack off for you real quick, but then you get out of here, sir. You and your weird tree body. Well, boys, I tried to take care of that situation the best I could. I jacked off in front of him and told him he could take off, but he ain't done neither. But bad news, he won't take off. Good news, we still got all our money. But I reckon we ain't fussing with that guy again. That man knows what he's doing right over there. That might be the bravest son bitch I ever seen in my life. Ain't him and his bird, buddy.
It's been 2 hours.
I tell you what, man, I fell in a hole over there. That guy's wild. He made me spread my butt cheeks for him.
He's a tree.
Felt like it at times. Boy, I'm kippered out. What do you say we lay back here and take some naps? I feel like I've been violated a little bit by that man, to be frank, which is...
All right. Yeah, we're going to leave you here, by the way.
Watch out. That guy's packing some major heat.
All right.
Yeah. I ain't never going to be the same.
No.
That guy's wild, man. Good dresser.
Oh, shit.
No pants.
So Dick goes to a roadhouse near Pico Rivera, and the tavern owner recognizes him from a wanted poster. And as Dick sat to eat, the owner pulled a pistol, quote, "Surrender, Dick, fellows, or I'll shoot you dead." Two patrons also jumped in, and Dick grabbed the gun barrel, and the gun went off, hitting Dick's right foot. But he got the gun away from the owner and blew out the candles on the table and ran out the door.
Happy birthday.
That's what you say when you do that.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
He rides over.
Okay.
He rides overnight to a farmhouse owned by Antonio Melahowitz, who is a friend in East LA.
Okay.
And he said he'd been shot at a dance the night before and he needed help.
It's quite a lie.
A doctor removes the bullet and patches him up. But then a posse sees Dick's horse and surrounds the house.
I cannot believe the level of identification that these people are. Yeah, the fact that they know him from a wanted poster and that they recognize his fucking horse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
That's wild.
So Dick tells Antonio to tell the posse he caught the villain known as Dick Fellows and to get the reward. Okay. So Dick Antonio.
Oh, okay. He's telling them, like, go grab the reward. I got him.
Yeah, he's telling his friend, like, you just turn me in. So Dick Antonio and the posse rode into L.A. where Dick was booked on December 9th, 1869.
Oh, okay. So they are really taking him in. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, his buddy turned him in. He told him to turn him in.
That ain't him at all. You don't look nothing like
Jesus
that.
Fuck, you that shut the him. Fuck up.
This guy's walking
you
and talking.
You shut up.
I'll tell you one big distinguishing difference, a face. Plus, he's got skin. The real Dick Fellows ain't got skin. And he make a man do whatever he wants in front of him. Matter of fact, he made me tug on myself.
All right.
I'd do it again if he asked. Yeah, I know. I won't relive it either. That was a dark day for me. All right. His orders were clear. His instructions were no joke.
Shut the fuck up.
He really made it very obvious what he wanted. Him and his bird buddy. This guy ain't even got a bird friend. So, plus he ain't got berries growing out of his fingernails. That other guy did. I ate one of them and got diarrhea. It's a tough day for all.
Don't shoot him. Don't shoot him. Don't shoot him.
Don't shoot who?
Don't shoot him. Don't shoot
him. Yeah, don't shoot him.
Don't shoot
him. Won't even matter. I shot him twice.
Okay.
Just went through him.
Mm-hmm.
Shirt didn't move or nothing. No pants on him either. Sorry. Go ahead.
Dick was convicted of robbing the man at Kuhunga, the stagecoach in L.A., an assault with intent to kill the tavern owner and given 8 years in San Quentin.
Shit. Wow.
He's
by the
a
way,
model.
The tavern owner shot his foot.
Yeah. So. Well, yeah, that's true. So he's a model prisoner integrating himself to lessen his sentence. Ingratiating himself to lessen his sentence. And he works at the new prison library and he becomes fluent in Spanish. He teaches other prisoners Spanish, literature, law, and classical philosophy, and he's well known for giving long lectures that convicts enjoyed because they have nothing to do.
Yep.
He organized a Sunday school Bible class.
Wow.
And after 3 years, Dick was seen as the de facto religious leader of the prison. Reporter visits and noted that Dick's religious lectures had, quote, a vigor and eloquence that struck terror into the souls of the minions of Satan.
Wow.
Yeah.
Seems a little biased, maybe.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah, it's a lot also.
Okay. So now that's taking on this, I thought it was like, you know, positives, but he's just like, the Satan will take you. He'll get you.
I mean, that's the standard.
Yeah. Suppose it is, yeah. A lot of it's fear.
The reporter also said Dick had seen the errors of his ways and turned himself around. He's reformed. Okay. He's a reformed man.
Right.
He only served 4 years of his 8-year sentence and was given an unconditional pardon by the governor on April 4th, 1874. And he walks out of San Quentin and then he kind of disappears for a while. We don't know where he is.
Okay.
James B. Hume was a detective working with Wells Fargo. And he wrote...
Like so
he wrote
got, nice.
Yeah.
This is a good time to introduce him.
He wrote Armed and Stagecoaches, and he also investigated robberies and tracked down bandits.
I'm hoping someday someone gets on a stagecoach that I'm sitting in. They ain't leaving with no big bounty. They'll just be leaving with a belly full of bullets. Hume.
Yeah, no, I...
Yeah.
He was so good that years later, he was known as the Sherlock Holmes of the West.
They call me Sherlock Humes. That's pretty good.
On December
4th, give it up, asshole.
It's just using the last name. It's not, Humes. It was disappointment. The face Stop. Was like,
Stop.
Say it again and watch my face.
Sherlock Humes. It's not great.
On December 4th, 1875, Hume stepped off a train in Caliente, California. It's a boom town located at the terminus of the Southern Pacific Railroad, about 27 miles east of Bakersfield. So he's there with two other heavily armed men to ride a stagecoach to L.A., loaded with three strong boxes containing $240,000 of gold coins.
Holy shit.
Which is about $7.5 million today.
Holy shit. Let's go.
As they unloaded the boxes from the train and onto the stagecoach, Hume noticed a familiar face in the crowd, San Quentin Prison's Sunday school teacher, Dick Fellows.
Wow.
Dick had come to Caliente to find honest work and was not planning on robbing a stagecoach, but...
This is too good.
Yeah, he sees all the armed security and how many people it took to lift the boxes, and he figures that's gold and a lot of gold. A lot. And he and a friend talk about it, and they decide to rob it. So they're going to meet a mile outside of town and do the holdup on a very narrow, winding road through the Tehachapi Mountains.
Okay.
So Dick rents a horse from Avis.
Yep. Obviously, I was going to say Hertz. Yep.
Yep. About a half mile outside of town, the horse suddenly stops.
We actually don't have the size horse that you ordered.
We're going to put you in a pony.
Would you take a dressage pony for the same price?
We have a great Shetland.
Yeah. Is something like, will that work? How about a donkey?
I have my own family.
How about a dog?
Okay.
Here, let me introduce you to Hank. You can ride him. It's a nightmare here now. Everyone quit working here.
It literally happened to me. Like, I was renting a car like 3 weeks ago from Enterprise, and it was Finn. It was for his birthday, and so I was like, "I'll rent you a nice car." What do you? And he picks out a nice car, and then I go there, and they're like, "Okay, here's your car," and it's like a fucking shitty sedan.
If you,
I'm like,
if you go to a rental car place and there's no line, and you get a car, you're like, "I can't believe what just happened." Yes. Like, I've had that happen, and I've been like, this is shocking. The feeling when you're getting off a plane to go get a rental car, like, I home alone through that airport.
Yeah.
I run through that airport because you know.
You O.J. Simpson through the airport.
Yes, I do. I kill people in my way and even waiters who are just with those people.
Mm-hmm. So he rents a horse, and then about a half mile outside of town, the horse suddenly stops and bucks, and Dick.
So it was Ava.
Yeah, it was it. So Dick hits the ground head first, and he's knocked out cold.
Wow.
The horse just runs back to its stable. That's what rental awesome. Horses will do.
Yeah. The horse is like, awesome.
And Dick was just laying face down on the road for hours. When he doesn't show up at the rendezvous, his friend figured Dick was caught. Hume and the 240,000 make it to L.A. with no issues.
Wow.
So Dick wakes up. He knows he's missed the big score because it's so much later.
Yeah.
But he still wants to rob somebody. He's like, well, I gotta get something in here.
This guy's good. This really is like, this is in his blood.
He's fixing for a robbery now.
Yeah.
You can't rent a horse to do a robbery.
You there, kid, give me your lolly.
Yeah. We've got to take something from someone.
Hey, I'm gonna cut your daughter's pigtails off, ma'am. You didn't say nothing.
So the return stagecoach would be coming that night from L.A., so he started walking back to Caliente, and he saw a horse tied up outside of a general store, so he stole it.
Okay.
And he's still on his way back, and then the lone highwayman is now out of retirement. No shots are fired. He does the robbery, goes off easy.
Okay.
But he had not brought any tools to open the strong box.
Okay.
So he looks for a big rock to break it open, but he can't find one. And he decides to open it somewhere else.
Is the reason he has to, there's no reason he has to open it there, right?
Well, he tries to put it on the horse's back.
It's too heavy.
But before he could, the horse breaks away and takes off running. The horse is like, shit. No, that's not what we're doing.
But what a great time for horses so far.
Yeah, no, yeah,
horse totally. Like, I'm not into that, honestly.
Yeah, they sound like they're in a union and they're like, nah.
Yeah, right, yeah.
So now, no horse. He starts dragging the heavy box back towards the town. And the Southern Pacific Railroad is blasting and tunneling through the mountains at this point. So
did they make the box particularly heavy, or was the gold in it just what made it heavy?
I think it's what's in it. Yeah.
Okay.
So Dick decided to, I'm sure it was heavy, but if you've seen it, it's like two like iron sort of straps. It's probably not that heavy.
Right. Okay.
So Dick decides to hide out in a tunnel, one of the ones that Southern Pacific is blasting. He makes his way through the hills in the darkness and suddenly fell 18 feet straight down into the blasted entrance of tunnel number 5 on the Tehachapi Railroad loop.
Shit. He's having a bit of a clumsy day.
Yeah, he really is. He breaks his left leg above the ankle.
Wait, that's his whole leg. That's his whole leg. That's like, yeah. Okay.
I'm not saying it all broke above the ankle. I'm saying just right above the ankle.
Oh, okay. Was break. I was like, man, he fucked every part of his leg. Was like, that's not good. At least my ankle's good.
And then the strong box is tumbling behind him and crushes his left foot.
Oh, fucking A.
He passes out from the pain.
Ugh.
And when he wakes, he slowly crawls, pushing the strong box in front of him.
You gotta love it. He's like a dung beetle.
He is. He's got to do this. And he pushes it up an embankment. And as dawn is breaking, he crawls into the campsite of some Chinese railroad workers.
Oh, my God. They're like, hello. Yeah. He's like a white dude is shattered with all that. They're like, yeah, feels like a trap.
Yeah, it doesn't seem good.
We're not, it feels like this could be bad for us in some way.
I don't want to die.
I need help.
So he gets an axe and he opens the strong box. There's only $1,800 inside, which is a lot less than the $240,000 on the way down. So he spent a day in a willow grove near Tehachapi Creek, where he fashioned some makeshift crutches.
Okay.
So now he's just full on MacGyver at this point.
Sure.
That night, he comes upon a barn with 3 horses inside. Mm. And he picks the one that looked the fastest, and he rides off. But the horse he stole had been temporarily fitted with one mule shoe instead of a horseshoe. So it's like having a flat
tire. So they have like a donut tire for horses?
Yeah, it's a donut tire for a horse. That's correct.
Okay. One mule shoe?
Yeah.
He knew when they were just running in circles. He's like, buddy, no.
I'm getting nowhere.
Come on, no.
Yeah, so mule shoes are shorter and smaller. So this leaves super identifiable tracks to follow.
Okay. Right.
And he was caught 3 days later and taken to the courthouse in Bakersfield.
Ugh.
On the way, Dick offers to give Deputy Muharin money.
It's great.
Except $50.
Except $50?
He needs that. He's going to give him the rest of the money, but he needs the $50.
For bus fare? Is it the same
thing? Dick needs, you got to have some money.
Yeah, sure, a little bit. Okay.
And he gave the other guy 50 when he robbed him.
So I would take this deal without question.
And he's like, I'll leave the country forever if you let me go.
Just Mexico?
Probably, yeah. Okay. Or the ocean?
Sure, Atlantis.
So Mulhern just took 500 for himself and turned Dick in anyway.
He's like, I like this guy too. I'm not gonna lie, I like this guy's style too. I like that guy's like, motherfucker, how about I just take 500 and I don't do shit for you?
When Detective Hume only got...
I'm gonna bribe myself to not take your bribe. How about that, Jagoff?
When Detective Hume got only $1,294 of the treasure, Dick told him about what Mulhern had done. And then Mulhern was fired from the Kern County Sheriff's Office.
All right, not a great move.
When they finally got him to a hospital, Dick's boot had to be cut from his foot because his leg had ballooned to twice his normal size. Your leg should never balloon. That's like...
God damn. So he was really... I mean, that box falling on your leg is...
That's bad.
Bad.
Yeah. On January 9th, 1876, he was indicted for highway robbery in Kern County. Using the name Richard Perkins, Dick pleaded guilty and, still on crutches, made a long and impassioned speech to the court begging for mercy.
Wait, why did he change his name?
He just told him a different name.
But Hume didn't know. Like, nobody. There was no...
So I don't know. They didn't connect. I mean, it's not L.A. Like, yeah. It's not in L.A. He's up in Kern County, so it's so a different great. Place.
God, it's yeah, you're so envious of a time where you could just do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. And what's your name? Richard Perkins. All right. And what'd you do? Jaywalked. Well, Mr. Perkins, look. I think you learned a lesson. You seem like a humble man.
Well, that's not what happened. He got 8 years.
Okay.
And Dick was put in the Bakersfield jail to wait for transport back to San Quentin. The Bakersfield jailhouse was a temporary structure that was made of wood planks.
I'm sensing
that's a problem. That, I mean, sure. I doubt I would say that if it wasn't going to have meaning.
Yes, unless someone was going to be like, you know, wood's actually... breakable.
Really
steel
easy.
No. Yeah.
So when the jailer came the next morning, he found some of the floorboards pulled
just
up.
Found a dick size hole in the wall. But now,
oh, shit.
Hang on a minute. Now it looks like. And when I say dick sized hole, I don't mean a glory hole.
I know.
For all you people having, that's disgusting.
Dick Fellows was on the lam once again. A reward of $550 was offered by the sheriff. That's about.
Well, he must have gone to Avis if he ended up on a lam. How much is it today?
That's stop. About $15,000 just shit. Over today.
Okay.
So he spends 2 days in hiding around the Kern River, and on day three, he tries to steal another horse. It has no saddle.
Okay, that's better, though. Still better. Hard.
It's better, but the balls.
The horse's balls?
No, the...
Your balls.
My balls.
Your balls, yeah. Although, does a saddle really do that much for your balls?
I don't know. Probably. I mean, it definitely makes a difference because it's hard to ride without a saddle.
Yes, yeah, harder to ride, but I don't know if that's a ball issue.
I think it's all ball. That's why the saddle is originally called the ball helper.
Huh. Okay. That's what the saddlebag is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So... He goes back to the barn to try to steal a saddle, and he tries to put the saddle on the horse, but it runs away. So now he's back on
foot. Horses, I mean, he must just, honest to God, it's his like Achilles heel is the horse.
Yeah, he's not good with horses.
The horses are just like, nah, my plan, I'm going to go be a horse. So, counterpoint.
A lot of the horses are just saying, you ain't putting that on me.
No, I'll leave you here. I'm going to go home.
So now he's on foot. So he heads.
At least he has a saddle, though. Now he's like, all right, I got a saddle. That's cool.
So he heads back to the swamp.
Oh, boy. That's always a fun.
By noon the next day, Dick is recaptured.
Wow.
Quote, I only succeeded in nearly perishing for days and days in those cold sloughs without food or shelter, only to be recaptured at last by a band of nincompoops.
Is that what they were calling themselves? Or?
Yeah, that was the official name.
So he basically is like, I almost died hiding, and then a band of idiots found me.
Basically, yeah.
Right.
He was sent to San Quentin on January 16th, 1876. His leg is still broken.
Jesus.
Prison officials made him open the doors for prisoners entering the dining hall, and he became nicknamed Lame Dick.
Because they're just trying to embarrass him, basically.
I just think that was, he had a limp or whatever. So
gotcha. Right. Okay. Right. Right.
They weren't talking about his actual dick. Is that what you thought?
No. Guys, get your mind out of the gutter. you're so gross.
They eventually gave his job back at the prison
lame
library.
Dick. If you heard someone say lame dick when you took your pants off, that would hurt.
Yeah, that would really hurt.
Lame dick.
So, after serving 5.5 years, Dick was paroled for good behavior in May 1881. He goes out and gets a job as a local reporter.
And I love that this guy's like, and I'll tell you what I'm not going to do. I've learned my lesson.
He became a local reporter and solicitor for the Daily Echo in Santa Cruz, California.
Daily Echo is a hilarious name for a journalist, publication. So what the New York Times said.
So what the New York Times said.
Yeah, that's basically it.
That's basically it.
No, I'm actually the... This is the
Daily Echo Echo.
So I'm actually... We're an original publication. We're just taking some stories and reprinting them from the New York Times, and you need to stop it. I am a dumb paper.
So, yeah, now he's a reporter. The LA Times in 1882.
Hey, look what my coffee mug is called.
Hello. he was an able writer, having a strong memory, being well-versed in ancient and modern history, and also having a good education, and having warm qualities of heart. He was capable of adorning any social or intellectual circle he might enter.
Remind you of anyone?
Me, yeah. Again. He took out an ad offering Spanish lessons under his new name, G. Brett Little, professor of languages.
Okay.
They call me the professor of accents. Did you know that?
No, they should not have.
It's a spicy meatball, huh?
Really bad.
He taught classes, but not enough to sustain him. Dick turned, guess how old he is?
Probably 40s.
Oh, pretty good. He's 36.
Okay.
There's been a lot of living.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there has.
So he's 36 on July 19th, 1881. And that same day, he robs a stagecoach in San Luis Obispo and gets
$10.
$10. It's not great.
So this is really, it's a little sad now. Yeah, he's in his 30s playing in like the D League.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah. So Dick heads to Duncan Mills near the Russian River in Sonoma County and robs a stagecoach on August 12th. When he broke open the strongbox, the only thing inside was a single document written in Chinese.
Oh, my God. What the fuck?
I think it's a spell. It's a spell.
What are they doing? Are they just doing decoy boxes?
No, it's got to be like a Chinese contract, probably between like two Chinese, like a tongs or something. Like, you know, it's got to be like a Chinese business. But
how much like, is the? does anyone know what this says?
It says the bearer is cursed.
Oh no.
He robbed two stagecoaches in Santa Barbara, then one out of Los Alamos on January 2nd. He yelled for the driver to throw out the strongbox, but the horses got spooked and ran.
And he's with the horses?
He was not with the horses. The horses took off with the stagecoach.
Don't they have like reins and shit?
What is he doing? He couldn't stop the stagecoach. If it runs, he can't stop them. Like,
he keeps being thwarted by horses.
He is. The horses are a problem.
The horses keep being his issue.
Yes.
He's going to die because of horses.
Yeah. By the way, I just watched a video last night, a guy doing donuts in L.A. in a McLaren. in the middle of the night, and then that just spins out and drives into a giant fucking building. Just like McLaren. Oh, God. So good.
It's a great time.
So he stops the same stagecoach six days later on its way back.
Okay.
And he recognizes the driver and he makes him turn over his gold because he escaped a week later when the horses took off.
Right.
So these robberies put the Sherlock Holmes of the West, James Hume, he's going after him.
Right.
And Hume feels, Hume and his special officer, Captain Charles Ayul, went town by town in Santa Clara Valley, giving out posters to everybody.
He's a real Watson.
They just missed him at Murphy's Hotel in Santa Cruz. They thought he was headed for San Francisco, where he could hide better because there's so many people.
Mm-hmm.
On January 26th, Dick hitched a ride with two men in a wagon headed for Mayfield. At a point, Dick asked the men to stop so he could get off and head another way.
Okay. So he's kind of trying to throw him off his scent. He must know he's being followed to some extent.
He must know.
So he's like, that's the way to do it. That'll follow that. And then he just gets off and, okay.
The driver said, quote, no, I guess you'll be going with us. And what? Jumped on Dick.
What?
Jumped on Dick.
Stop.
Jumped on.
Why would they? Why? Oh, because they're trying to get him. They're trying to turn him in.
And then there was a fight. Constable Cornelius Van Buren was passing by and jumped into the fight. The San Jose Mercury. Van Buren, quote, you are my prisoner. A desperate struggle ensued, during which Fellows was felled to the ground. When he was disarmed and secured, it required the united efforts of all three men who were unarmed to overpower him.
Wow.
Dick was turned over to a Santa Clara constable named Burke. And Burke found the stolen gold watch on him, which confirmed his identity. And he telegraphed ahead to San Jose to let them know he was delivering the lone highwayman, Dick Fellows.
Okay.
Detective Hume wrote later, quote, Fellows began working upon Burke's self-conceit and lost no time in filling him up with the important part he had played in effecting the capture. Hinted at fabulous sums of money he had stowed away, the result of his many robberies, for which there would be large rewards offered until Burke became so inflated with his importance that he looked on Fellows more as a benefactor than a prisoner.
Hmm.
This guy's my cash cow.
Yeah, that was well done.
So at Mountain View, they stop for dinner. And Burke brags to the bartender the importance of who he has. And he starts to feel honored by the presence and patronage of such a prisoner.
Wow. That's such a, what a weird captor.
It's so weird.
I'm lucky to have him. He's my best friend.
In San Jose, they rode right past the jail and entered the Arguello House Saloon for a drink. And Fellows managed to pour out an extra large horn in spite of his handcuffs. A horn. I kind of remember what a horn is, but I think it's just like a giant amount of beer.
Okay.
After drinking, but he's pouring it out somehow, I think is what they're saying.
Instead of he's getting dude drunk.
I think so, yeah.
Right, okay.
After drinking, both left the saloon.
I'll tell you what, man. You're like, you know how to drink. You're real good.
After drinking, both left the saloon. As they stepped out, the handcuffed Dick Fellows suddenly shoved Burke forward upon his face and ran away in the darkness.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, he just got him drunk and then pushed him down.
Why?
The slow Mickey.
A felon.
I mean, it's just like the idea that this is like a cash grab and you can't stay sober for the day.
Mm-hmm.
That's how everyone seemed to be.
Yeah. It's really crazy.
Well, what about if we get blackout drunk before you take me in?
So, Burke and the bartender gave chase while shooting into the dark.
Okay.
It's always...
Seems like they're doing a good job.
A drunk guy and another guy shooting in the dark. One of the shots ricocheted off the handcuff on Dick's left hand.
And what luck! His palm. What?
I know, right? I mean, it's so insane. So he keeps running till he escapes. Then now about 50
men. They shoot like oil next to him. Like, oh shit. Fucking beautiful. keep shooting. We're making his life better.
So now there's about 50 men looking for him across San Jose.
Okay.
And Dick breaks into a barn of a retired dentist named W.F. Gunkel.
I'm Dr. Gunkel. And what I do is I remove the Gunkel from the mouth.
It's not a good name. It's not a good name. It's you not know, a good name.
I call plaque Gunkel.
It's not a good name for a person.
Okay. I'm like a goofy uncle. I like to have fun. I'm your Gunkel.
It's not. Oh, yeah. It got worse.
I'm Dr. Gunkel.
So he hides out in his barn, and in the morning he breaks into the cellar and steals some food and wine and beer and a hatchet to break the chain off his handcuffs.
It's amazing that when it comes to survival supplies, most of it's alcohol.
Yeah, right. 5 days later, Gunkel goes to his barn to get
Gunkel
some hay.
Gunkel goes to his barn. Gunkel. Sounds like the first book you read a child.
So he's stabbing at the bale of hay, and he hit Dick, who yells and jumps up.
This hay just said, ouchie.
Howdy. He said he was a degenerate drunk who hid there because some boys had been pelting him with rocks.
It would be a red flag if a man's first thing is like, you see, I'm a degenerate drunkard. Down on my luck, I have nothing left to lose, and some boys were throwing rocks at me.
I'm being harangued by children.
I'm a huge piece of shit. Don't shoot.
So Gunkel feels bad and helps Dick tidy up. And seeing that Dick has no hat, he gave him an old hat.
You look ridiculous.
You look terrifying, sir. Terrifying.
Come into Gunkel's closet.
You hatless drunk. So then Gunkel starts to lecture Dick about sobriety.
Look,
and,
Dick's sitting there like, uh-huh, sure.
Yes.
Look, I know why you're here.
Uh-huh.
You have a problem drinking.
Okay, so.
Booze can be really good. Hey. Cider, ales, even some of the hardest. Hold on.
Okay.
You're too old for this. You're too old for this. What you need to do is find your, shut up. What you need to do is find yourself a wife. You're running around partying, beer ponging, probably butt chugging, doing all your weird little stuff. And look, that's fun for a while, but you need to settle down, son. Okay? Don't let alcohol take the reins anymore.
Hey, listen, I'm older than you.
Hmm. You ever heard the name Gunkel?
Unfortunately, yes.
That's who I am.
I have it all over my teeth.
Yeah. Yep. Maybe we should get married.
I don't think so.
Okay. Yeah, I pushed the pitch.
So he's trying to, get Dick sober.
Lecturing
so
him.
Dick. Yeah. So as he's lecturing him, Dick just takes off running.
What? Hey, what? I'm not that important.
At that point, Gunkel remembers this circular that he'd received about a robber. And he goes and tells the sheriff, Dick, I stopped at a boarding house and read an account of my escape in a newspaper.
That's fun.
Entering a canyon, came to a cabin. A woman was there who told me her husband would soon be back for supper and that if I would wait until he came back, I could have something to eat. I had been there for a short time when the dog began to bark. I supposed her husband was coming and was not uneasy. In a few minutes, I learned my mistake. two San Jose cops enter the cabin with their guns out.
Okay.
So Dick is brought to the San Jose jail to wait for Detective Hume to take him to Santa Barbara for trial.
Hume's probably excited.
Yeah. For 2 days, they put him on display.
That's so weird.
700 people come to look at the legendary stagecoachman.
He's a guy.
It got him in a cage. So
this was
like
worth it.
Yeah.
Hey, look. Woo! Look at him breathing. Woo, like a man.
He is a human.
Wow. So weird.
It's such a bizarre thing.
So strange.
So far.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, so, I mean, that's also for you. You're like, yeah, hi.
Wow. A man who robbed.
So, tales of his exploits, they're a sensation in papers all across the country. A cocktail, it was said, he ordered right before his escape from Burke became popular in San Jose.
Hmm.
On the ride to Santa Barbara, Hume interviews Dick, and he confesses to 6 of 7 stagecoach robberies. And Dick said, someone else did the $10 robbery on my birthday the previous summer. He's like, I'm not going to cop to the $10.
So this is purely an ego admission, because he's just basically like, I'm not that pathetic.
Yeah, I didn't do that.
So the crimes you're admitting to, you'll get more time for, but the one you won't admit to is that petty, weird one. I don't work on my birthday.
Yeah, it's not great. I didn't do that. So over 100 people come to watch the trial, and he defends himself because the court could not wait for his lawyer to arrive from Oakland, which seems not constitutional.
That seems like bullshit. Yeah.
It's kind of a part where you get to defend yourself.
Law. Yeah.
You get an attorney. Like,
yeah. Yes. Yeah. That you're allowed to have that.
Yeah.
Is there one closer? No.
No, just Oakland. His defense was that Wells Fargo was engaged in illegal business, so it wasn't a crime to steal from them.
So good.
Not wrong.
So good.
Not wrong. He tried to make a 49-page speech that he'd written about the difficulty of getting a fair trial when a corporation was involved.
Oof.
Again.
God, not wrong. Damn.
And the judge cut him off. Well, 49 pages is long.
Oh, it's long.
It's long.
Do you know how far in he made?
No, like what, I don't know, no, but yeah. I mean, that's days, I would assume.
Oh,
49
yeah.
pages.
Yeah.
The judge cuts him off. The jury finds him guilty on all counts. He was sentenced to life in the new Folsom prison, and Dick said he had new lawyers and he would appeal.
Okay.
Well, a lawyer.
Yeah.
I got it's a new lawyer, from Oakland. It's not me. It's
the
not
guy finally me. Got here. All right. Now, let's do this. How'd it go? Shit, okay.
I'm going to jail. I got convicted. You
weren't
here.
Yeah, sorry. Oakland is so far. I was walking backwards.
What?
From there to get to you, yeah.
Why?
I'm trying to break a record.
Okay, well, that's fair, actually.
Oh, so how'd it go? What'd you do?
That's why the crowd is here.
They're excited, yeah.
Well, I got convicted of robbing 7 stagecoaches.
Okay, so I'll go back. I'll get my papers, and then we can start an appeal.
One I didn't do.
Right. Great.
Or any of them.
Better. Sure. Okay. Great to see you.
Good to see you.
Bye.
Are you backwardsing up, too?
Yeah, I'm going to backwards to Oakland. Yep. Okay. So we can appeal about 2 to 3 years.
Okay. On April 2nd, a deputy opened Dick's cell for breakfast, and Dick jumped down from his shelf. Quote, it's life or death for me, and I'm going to get your revolver.
Waffles.
Just explain the whole thing.
Yeah. I am surprising you to hopefully convince you that I'll be able to get out of here quickly because I can't take this anymore. It's an escape, Jack.
I'm jumping from a shelf.
I've hopped from a higher ground to your level.
He took the deputy's gun, locked up the deputy, and ran towards the Santa Ynez Mountains.
Hmm.
The deputy's wife screamed, and every cop on duty was immediately in pursuit. Townspeople also joined in. Dick sees a horse. It is tied up to a stake and it is in the middle of a field.
Just don't fucking go to it.
This is going to work.
No. Go to the mountain. No, don't put your plan.
It's like a gift from God.
No, it isn't. It's going to like bite him.
He hops on the horse.
And it what?
But the horse was tied up all by itself because it was recovering from eating a plant called Oxytropis capsicum, known as loco weed.
Sorry. The horse he found was tripping?
Yep.
So he gets on the back of a tripping horse.
It has...
Brother, I'm a unicorn.
You need to put on some Floyd.
Okay.
It has severe neurological
I think it's
effects.
Very strange that you ride me. I would imagine in some parallel universe I ride you. Or maybe we don't ride each other. Either way, every ride comes at a cost. Oh.
So, this loco weed has severe neurological effects on horses. They become very dizzy, erratic, and uncoordinated. Like they're drunk.
Perfect. So, yeah, you got on a drunk horse.
Yeah.
Quite a choice.
There we go. Dick kicked the horse in the ribs, and it takes off. He made it 6 blocks from the jail when the horse went into a fit and bucked, and then Dick was thrown to the ground. He was quickly surrounded with guns pointed at his face and taken back to the jail and he asked if he could have breakfast.
You know, I actually will take the eggs now.
Yeah, that was the whole jumping down thing. I was trying to
get some sauce for the Benedicts.
Sausages.
Some hollandaise.
Yeah.
Boy, he Folsom, picked a bad horse.
Yeah, he really did. He picked the worst horse.
Yes.
In Folsom, he's a model prisoner again, and he's the prison librarian, sure. And he's the teaching, and he wrote letters to newspapers and obituaries for old friends and countered when papers said he had done a crime that he had not done. After 15 years, in 1896, he's 51 years old, and people are asking for him to be pardoned. They're like, okay, it's enough. And the judge in his last trial petitioned the court, the prison board, for him to be pardoned. And then Detective Hume is like, yeah, he should be pardoned. As did the president.
Why? Just
of
because
Fargo.
He's like a national treasure in some way?
I think because he's so well behaved and right. Gentlemanly that everyone's like, well, come on.
Let him go.
He didn't kill anybody or anything. Like, it's not that bad.
No, he gave that guy $50.
Thank you. Dick said he was old and would just go live a quiet life south of the border. And after 26 years, he is paroled by Lieutenant Governor Warren Porter. On March 8th, 1908, Dick Fellows walked out of Folsom a free man.
And then a horse trampled him.
And then a horse killed him. His sister met him at the train station and accompanied him back to Kentucky.
The train. He was sitting on the train like, mm-hmm.
Back home, he went by the name Professor G. Britton Little and wrote, he never mentioned his former life as Dick Fellows. He told a reporter after he got out of the Civil War prison camp, he went to Canada, then Cuba, then South America, and worked for railroads, and his scars were from the war. So he's just saying he's not that guy. The San Francisco Call, quote, he was released on parole here in 1908 and is so completely reformed that he has turned to writing fiction and magazine stuff under a name which need not be disclosed here. No, he is not a muckraker.
Wow.
No one in Kentucky knew that Dick Fellows and Professor G. Britton Little were the same person. The professor became the associate editor of the Mountain Advocate paper. Then he became chief interpreter and translator in the offices of the Guatemalan Consulate General in New Orleans. In 1915, he was appointed head interpreter at the Days of 49 camp at the Panama Pacific International Exposition in San Francisco, and he went. On the West Coast, he was still Dick Fellows. This is from the San Francisco Examiner. The professor eventually landed back in Kentucky. He traveled to Kentucky. Okay.
Sure.
The professor eventually landed back to Kentucky. He traveled the region giving Spanish lessons. In 1920, U.S. Census lists him as a 72-year-old single teacher, Spanish teacher, living in the home of his sister and her husband. In 1922, he wrote a letter to the editor advocating for mandatory Spanish education in schools. He died sometime around 1932.
Hmm. God damn.
He's almost 90 years old.
Quite a life, though.
Yeah, pretty crazy life, right?
Yeah, I also think it's like he was making the point back then that he's stealing from corporations.
Yeah, just, I mean, that's a Robin Hoodie long time thing, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's a shame now that Robinhood is just a like a day trading app that when people use GameStop, shut everyone out. How fucked up is that? App called Robinhood shut people out of, you know, buying a stock to undo a hedge fund.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
To bankrupt a hedge fund.
Sources, California Desperados, Stories of Early California Outlaws in Their Own Words by William Seacrest, Perilous Trails, Dangerous Men, Early California Stagecoach Robbers and Their Desperate Careers by William Seacrest, Bad Company, The Story of California's Legendary Stage Robbers, Bandits, Highwaymen, and Outlaws by Joseph Henry Jackson, Outlaw Tales of California, True Stories of the Golden State's Most Infamous Crooks and Culprits, Cutthroats by Chris Enns, Wells Fargo Detective, A Biography of James Hume by Richard Dillon, articles in the Kern County Historical Society Quarterly Bulletin, the Temecula Valley Historical Society, the Santa Barbara Independent, the South Valley Tribune, the Tehachapi News, Unmasked U.S. History, Yankee Barbarino?
It's me, Yankee Barbarino.
Iki Civil War blog, Stories of the Appalachian podcast, The History Guy, and then Press Telegram, Los Angeles Herald, Sacramento Bee, Sacramento Daily Union, Sacramento Calls, San Francisco Examiner, Son of Mucker News, San Luis Obispo Tribune.
Jesus Christ.
The Tracy Press, The Mountain Advocate, The Lexington Herald, Ledger, The Louisville Courier Journal, The Owensboro Messenger Inquirer, The Bourbon News, The St. Louis
Bourbon News
Democrat, The Western Christian Advocate, and The Knoxville Sentinel.
I got an idea for an article. I think you know, it's also so fucking crazy how old Wells Fargo is and how long they've been doing it
and how long they've just been fucking
the worst,
terrible, like how, like, that's a great example of like a company being so bad for so long and they still get to exist. But corporations are people, but just not no punishment.
Yeah, no, it's fucking
like they
crazy.
Should have gotten the death penalty ages ago.
Yeah. Well, that's good. It's always nice to end on a sad note somehow.